So, getting used to another schedule. I'm kind of switching the poles now because waking up early the way I have been, it's pretty awesome. But, my husband's going to be home or will get home at around that time. And what I figured, since he's living kind of like a swing shift, almost like graveyard schedule type of thing, that I wouldn't necessarily be swing shift graveyard, but I would figure out what meals are going to be cooked using the crock pot when I will do my Facebook lives, so I don't feel like I'm encroaching upon his space or shouting, because sometimes I shout and get loud when I do my Facebook lives, and I don't want to do that at 5 in the morning and he's trying to sleep. And so now it's kind of doing a switcheroo and having that freedom when I have the house to myself, when it's appropriate. And right now, yeah, it's appropriate. And so I've been so interested in old Hollywood the last for a while, and a lot of my upbringing came from old Hollywood, as well as new Hollywood and new programming. Because when you have parents that are from the silent generation, and then they have parents from the great generation, you're getting so much of the memories, the culture, the background of those in the 1920s, 1930s, even as far as 1900. Or a little bit before that, because people have children at a young age, so the difference between generations could be at least 20 years. Okay. And so then, so then you look at when old Hollywood came into being, and you know about, at least some of you know about in the conspiracy world, about the MK Ultra, the Diamond programming, Marilyn Monroe. All the trauma-based programming that we know about, at least with the Bob Hopes and what's her name? Thanks for the memories. I gotta figure out her name. What is it? What is it? Bob Hope. Bob Hope. Let's say thanks for. Thanks for the memories. There's Kissinger. Oh yeah, Kissinger. Who else? Taylor, right. Bryce Taylor. Is it Bryce Taylor? Yeah. Hold on, is it? Hold on. Bryce Taylor. Thanks for the memories. Bob Hope. Bryce Taylor, yeah. So Bryce Taylor, book by Bryce Taylor, Thanks for the Memories. That was in the early 1950s, and them doing major mind control. And of course, a lot of CIA stuff, programming people to carry secrets and then get triggered, and trauma-based programming and all of that. So a lot of old Hollywood, actually old Hollywood with, like I watched Kiss, or was it Call Me Kate? Which is out of Netflix, and it's hot in here, so sorry, but she reminds me of people that I know or knew. The structure, the dynamicness, yeah, and I know that in the background of where I was raised, definitely. The entertainment industry is somewhere in play. My grandma was a scat singer, I guess. I didn't know what the hell scat singing was. I heard about it, but I asked my husband. I was watching Call Me Kate, and I'm like, "Have you heard of scat singing?" And he was like, "Yeah, it's my husband knows a lot about music, and he actually did an example." I'm like, "Oh, really?" So I'm like, "Yeah, Google the scat man." That's why I posted the scat man. Because I didn't really know what scat was. I mean, I kind of knew, but not really. And or if I did knew, I forgot about it. So I know that there's definitely a lot of programming that happens in families, even back all as far back as Great Generation, Silent Generation, and then you have the 1950s, and you have a very specific man and woman, dark haired man, tall, dark and handsome, blonde, blue eyed woman. That was the going thing, and you saw Hollywood. Oh my God, old Hollywood, Clark Gable, Cary Grant, Spencer Tracy, all of those just gods and goddesses of old Hollywood. And then you see their offspring, which were the adults or college age in the 80s when they were doing movies like Dustin Hoffman. But he was like in 1969, but it's 1980s where he's doing like Tootsie and all those different movies that we know about, like with Tom Cruise. Oh God, I forgot that name of that movie where he was autistic. And so you see the programming. That's the thing, is old Hollywood, the women were like so tall, so tall, so like finely chiseled features, like Katharine Hepburn. And you watch that Call Me Kate and you see that nervous energy. That's like a type A, type B blood type. I've seen that nervous energy before. There was a lot of genetic programming even back then, but it became more pronounced in the conspiracy world in the 1950s because of Bob Hope and Bryce Tedder's book, and then of course all the Fritz Springmeier and the Illuminati stuff and all those storylines that we come to know about very well in the conspiracy world. But when you look at old Hollywood, yeah, there was definitely programming going on, and it started off the agenda of getting people programmed, of course, to look a specific way. Of course, the sexual revolution came in the 1960s, but that this 1920s and 1930s were all part of that. Okay, the women breaking the boundaries, and of course, Katharine Hepburn wearing pants instead of a skirt. Everything that we kind of come to know about today, women breaking boundaries. And I guess when you think about it, I was bred to be something like that, obviously, because of the amount of exposure to so many different things in arts and entertainment, not all the entertainment, the filtering of what I'm watching on TV or even the movies. I wasn't allowed to watch certain things, believe me. I was programmed for something very specific. Didn't know what the actual intention was, but at this point, it doesn't even matter. The outcome is the intention. Okay? Because, I mean, there's a reason why I haven't turned to drugs or alcohol or anything like that, or even really sex as an outlet. I mean, yeah, now, probably before, yes, I'm sure something like that was an outlet, having a bunch of boyfriends and all that. But now I released that programming. Now everything came out in the wash. Okay? If you survive all the programming that was forced on you, everything comes out in the wash, and then you get an awesome type of background because you understand, like, your memories span the ages and you can see the connections. You have a place to go if you get stressed out to channel stuff. Artistic ability, be able to see the connections very quickly. I'll tell you, if you don't have that kind of background, you can develop it. It's all what you feed your mind. That's the thing, is now that you have the internet, now that you have everything at your fingertips, you can Google Art Deco. You can Google 1930s, 1920s. You can watch old movies. You can see the type of programming that was going on back then. You can Google anything you want. You can study anything you want. There's nothing that stops people from going outside of what was given to them, but what stops them is their own programming. Because the roadblocks that was given to them by their parents is like, if you study this, if you look at this, it's satanic. That's horrible. You're gonna get programmed. And I'm like, there are so many people that are watching me, and some of them can be really like legalistic. And I'll tell you, I'm not trying to destroy anything that you hold dear. I have my own beliefs based upon my background and all that stuff. I'm not trying to change you. Can you still have your current beliefs And can you still change and develop and surpass all the things that are, well, not surpass, could you survive the Great Reset despite your lifestyle, your politics, your religion, your science? I don't know. Okay. So many types of people watch these videos, and some have been very radicalized by their religions, by their politics, by their science. And I'm trying to give you a chance to live beyond what was set for you. I am not the enemy. I will never be your enemy. I'm trying to give you something else to understand. And I'm not forcing it on you. I'm putting it out there, but I'm not going into your world and trying to convert you. I'm not walking into your house and saying you need to do this, this, and this. Nobody is going into your houses. Nobody is going onto your Facebook. I mean, people do, and you can block them. But nobody's coming into your world and forcing you to change if you don't want to change. Okay? And so I'm trying to give you a chance to live beyond what was set for you. I am not the enemy. I will never be your enemy. I'm trying to give you something else to understand so you can survive this great reset. I'm telling you, the system is trying to release the memories they deem undesirable at this point. It's anyone who can't handle the change. Intolerant people. And so they definitely have prototypes that were developed back in the 1920s, 1930s. And then, of course, you have the 1940s with HITLER doing even more human experimentation. So he had a specific prototype, as we know what that is. I mean, you can read history. And of course, we can't live like that. That's the best prototype. It has been developed to be the more tolerant, but not really, as far as tolerant to longevity. And even desirability because of the media and social constructs, but then also the milk, the cream, okay? And so everyone's bred for something very specific. And so there are specific types of people that they have deemed desirable back in the 1920s and 30s. Then reproduction got out of control because of the intentions of human experimentation. Like Universe 25, John Bumpus Calhoun's mice experiment, trying to give you another way. Again, you may not be able to save your kids because right now you can barely save yourself, but at least parents have a chance. Adults have a better chance than children at this point. Some kids even make it back in the 80s. Okay, have you followed everyone back from when you knew them in grade school, middle school, high school to today? Did they disappear? Did they die from a cancer disease and chronic illness? Do they fall through the cracks? Do they run away from home and never come back? Were they kidnapped? Okay. I mean, do you know where everyone is from when you grew up? Probably not. People lose touch with each other. They don't follow each other. If they have a circle of people, it's very homogenized from in high school. Okay. And so you gotta realize that, yeah, there's so much human experimentation. And so the whole Call Me Kate, Netflix, and old Hollywood, MK Ultra human programming, 1920s scat singing, all of that stuff is even coming back through Netflix. And of course, you see people, even new Hollywood, try to replicate what happened way back when, as you see in some of these Netflix shows. Like the new alpha, beta, millennial generation wearing their flapper outfits and trying to look like someone from way back when. But it's like, okay, there's a specific look that was way back when. Now, with the people that exist today trying to copy that look, it's as if you're wearing a costume, which it was a costume, but back then it was like the reality, it was the thing. But today, everything, as far as history and the costumes of history, it's basically all costumes and acting and all that. Okay, and so today I was a little bit, I won't say bitter, but I was just like, way to go, moms, the right-wing Christians and left-wing liberals, skeptical of the VAX, both claim to be organic and they have some remedy or operation for you, right? Not to mention some strain of cannabis that they're recommending for you. That's the system messing with people. That was done intentionally. Because all of a sudden there is unity and destruction. And I didn't read this before because I kept the last video, really short because my husband, I wanted to make him breakfast and I knew that he was up and all that. So I was feeling, I would say, pressured. So I didn't read this part. But yeah, that's the system messing with people. That was done intentionally. All of a sudden, there is unity in destruction. So then you think about the left and the right and the center, and the atheists and the Christians and the agnostics and all the different, LGBTQ and the straight people all are unified in destroying themselves simply because of the way they deal with evolution, the way they deal with their symptoms, the way they deal with change. Something to stop, something to cure, something to surgically take out, something to develop an activist stance against. I mean, and so when you think about all the manufactured wars that are out there, what's the end result? You pass away anyways. And on your way out the door, be as anesthetized as possible, feeling absolutely nothing, and be distracted and chase pleasure. And don't ever deal with your pain or trauma in a way that keeps you going. And so then here I am going like, okay, fine, you can be a Christian, fine, you can be a liberal left, you can be a right wing, whatever. But then with that adoption of an ideology, with that belief system, that lifestyle, that category that you have adopted, comes then the lifestyle of how you react to symptoms. Comes then and are a packaged deal that is already in of itself destructive. And so anyone that goes in and challenges that, no matter what, will challenge people's identities and they'll think you are the enemy. That was built in. You cannot try to change people and tell them that they can survive and give them meat, milk, cheese, and eggs when already their religion, their politics, their science dogma says no meat, no milk, no cheese, no eggs, hardly any food, and here take all your surgeries and believe that you're gonna get absolution when you close your eyes and never open them ever again. Holy crap, that was embedded in those specific religions. So anyone that even challenges that will be deemed satanic, will be deemed an enemy, will be deemed messed up, will be deemed someone who is against God. Okay? And so then what is a person who's afraid to deal with that kind of backlash? Then they shut up because they don't want to deal with people going like, "Oh my God, you're being satanic. Oh my God, you're challenging my identity. Oh my gosh, this." When actuality, they're going like, "Dude." Then there is that implied, "I'm going to try to save you." And I'm doing something that's no different than what they think they're doing. And so then the whole wars of saving each other, that was unintentionally too. Okay? Because when we have a belief system, no matter what, in politics, religion, and science, that you should die someday, it's not going to matter what the hell you believe. It's not going to matter how soon, when, whose fault it is, when you have the scapegoats. When you have all that psychological programming, all the psychological operations, no matter which way you go to try to do what you naturally do as a human, as a cell, trying to stay alive, to save other cells, to convert other cells to stay alive, to join together to survive, using your survival instincts as a weapon against your own children, as a weapon against everyone around there, that's psychological programming. When my sister and I was weaponized against my own sister. Okay? That's psychological programming. And so, when you are weaponized against other people, it's not going to matter what you say or what you do because purely anything coming out of your mouth, and they don't care, it doesn't matter what it is. When you've been weaponized against somebody else, they will not listen to a fucking word you say. Everything that you say will come out through their filter of they hate you, they don't like you, they see your religion, your politics, your science, and they won't hear anything. And so when you've been weaponized against your friends and family and other people out there and you start speaking, it's going in through one ear and out the other. That was all intentional too. When my sister and I were weaponized against each other, actually, I was weaponized against her, I was a scapegoat. Jillian's the problem. Jillian is from Vietnam. She's a starving orphan. She has medical issues. She has psychological issues. She's fucked up. She's this, she's that. And so then I became the scapegoat for whatever, was going on at the time. And you're just acting out of programming. Don't know if it's right or wrong, and you're just trying to survive and do what is natural, which is negotiate survival, and survival can mean coming out of your room. Who's the strongest one? You're pitted against somebody else at 5 years old, 4 years old. And then that carries all the way through until everyone leaves because they can't handle the weapons they have developed ever since, like, toddlerhood. But see, that may happen there, like that may happen then, but then you look out there in the population, you look at your religions, you look at your science dogmas, you look at your politics, you've been weaponized against everyone in your own fucking neighborhood. Like literally, and we have kids weaponized against people because of what they've been taught. But remember, all the religions, the legalistic religions, all the science dogmas, all the hippie stuff was given to you by your parents, grandparents, relative to how old you are. It's all in the conspiracy world, in the holistic world, in the medical world. It's like you have been weaponized against everyone that you come across. You go into these groups out there, you have been weaponized against anyone that follows you. Especially if you're promoting the herbs, the pills, the powder supplements, the detoxes, the surgeries, religion, politics, science, dogmas. And it's everywhere. You can't go anywhere without somebody radicalized in something that have been turned into a warrior. And they wear the costumes. And sometimes they don't wear costumes. It's already inside. And you just trigger them and they're like freaking out over whatever. And so that's the system messing with people. That was done intentionally. The whole 1960s, the division, the cults, all the yoga stuff, all the communes, and then the whole holistic stuff. That was all done intentionally. That was the Tower of Babel. That was everyone being weaponized against each other. All of a sudden now there's unity. Now there's unity in destruction. So even though you're all divided and you're all going like, oh my God, you do this, you do that, you do not do this, you do not do that. The end result is you're all destroying, you're all basically going to destroy yourself and other people with all of your remedies, your marketing of all your pills, power supplements, and detoxes, and all the different surgeries, and of course, joining together to fight some invisible enemy that hasn't even stepped foot into your house unless you invite them in or they have a warrant. Okay? And so now you're all conjoined together, linked together, unified against an invisible enemy and also into destruction, into self-destruction. That's fucking brilliant. That's not only MK Ultra, trauma-based programming, but that's MI5, MI6, that's CIA. That's Central Intelligence. Fucking brilliant. And CIA, MI5, MI6 go right into academia, into the psychology, sciences, behavioral sciences, biotech. And of course, you have people out there that are agents for the system, but you'll never know. Or their kids were trained and they didn't know they were trained. There's undetectable mind control people who just act out their programming because they don't remember it. It was embedded into their community. Everybody was doing it. Everybody was under the same programming. How many people were under the same program? It lived next door to each other in Silicon Valley. You could probably have neighborhoods of basically mind-controlled people, part of a CIA project. You'll never fucking know because it may not get declassified until years later because I'm still alive. Eventually, all this shit will get buried. I'm going to shut up. I'll write a book about it. And you know, and people who were doing that are all dead, right? They're all in their 80s and 90s and 70s, passed away. And so then, just like with, you know, with that hippie guy, the one that started the hippie beatnik stuff, Ken Kelsey something, he's dead. So you can't blame him. I mean, you can blame him, but why blame a dead dude? And then look what he started, a whole several generations of hippies who are at war with each other. But they claim to be peaceful, but they wear the costumes and they're at war with everything. And then somebody else comes in and radicalizes people who already hold that programming. That's fucking brilliant. And so people not from California want to say that California is full of fruits and nuts. Where the fuck do you think you get your culture from? Einstein is where I'm getting like, you know, snarky. California was the hub of the programming. They gave you all of your belief systems. Your shit is not organic. If it was, you'd be dead. Organic is chaos because you'd be full of chaos. They organized your activism, your whole life. All of you are genetically modified, and your belief system was given to you. So who's a fruit and nut? We all are until we release the demons, until we release that programming and program ourselves and expose ourselves to so much information without it traumatizing us to the point of destruction or anyone else. And we understand and see patterns, and to where we don't need to read the laws in order to, well, we need to read the laws, yes, but we don't need to have law enforcement come in and keep us in line because we already know the laws of how stuff works. We know the laws of nature, the laws of mankind, we know the laws of our society. Okay, and you're like, well, there's some unjust laws. No, there's laws that says don't steal, don't hurt somebody else, don't recommend a pill, powder, supplement unless you're a doctor, not even a nurse, but a doctor who knows a person's history that is licensed to go and recommend a cure, an extract. But those were only enforced selectively because you see all over Facebook everyone recommending each other or everything under the fucking sun to stop symptoms, to stop everything. Or they recommend what their doctor recommended, and they have a prescription, like, oh, you should take what I'm taking, this prescription drug, as if they have any business recommending what their prescription is meant for them, not for somebody else. But we have that all, but that's not enforced. People don't get arrested for that. And so there is part of the system that says, okay, yes, yeah, against the law to do that, but we'll only enforce it if you become so influential, and then you have a following of people who are listening to your every word and taking all of those antibiotics and destroying themselves. And there's actual correlation equals causation, which is why Dr. Sebi and other people, Justin Trudeau, was all about the holistic stuff. They had the FBI, all the different government agencies stopping his practice, their practices of recommending cures because they were causing death. It was antibiotic. See, salt isn't poison. Salt and water isn't poison. Okay, if you have salt in your system, you drink water. You need electrolytes. But the way the system spun it, they wanted to turn it into something that it wasn't. But that's the thing. You need electrolytes. You need water. You need milk. You need meat. Well, you need protein. You know, you need meat. Okay. But you need complete proteins. You need a diverse food supply. You need rest. All right. And so all of you are genetically modified and your belief system was given to you. Okay. So who's the fruit and nut until you release those demons? And so all of us are until we finally realize we've been programmed and to release the programming. A postdoc, a student, once told me that San Francisco was the center of the universe. He wasn't wrong, but that was 20 years ago. Okay. And so right now there is an excessive aging process going on. I see it in people my age or even younger. People my age and even younger. I'm telling you, I don't feel like I look like I'm 50. I'm Googling people who are 50 years old, and they look at people like my parents. Back when I was 15, 20, 30, and with my parents who are like 40 or 50 or 60. But I don't feel like I look like someone who's 50 years old. Maybe you might think that or whatever, that's fine. But when you bring in the milk, when you bring in the food supply, when you finally release those demons and you finally take on the weight and release the excessive stuff and you finally fill in your face that might be releasing collagen because the body is being actively cannibalized, when you finally fill all that stuff in and you face your demons and you stay home and rest. And you're not gallivanting everywhere all the time, not resting. You finally let go of all the warrior attitude that you have to go fight something all the time, which is an American attitude, is fight, 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 war, 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 go to war with anyone who cares, lob the first grenade if you have to. When you finally get out of the war, your life will come back. Because guess what? You're bringing the energy back into your body, into your mind, into your spirit. You're not allowing the demons and the vultures come in and just pick away at every part of your soul. And again, if you're having a bunch of kids, those kids are taking so much from you. Hey, kids are great. They are until they grow up. And now what did you produce? And how much are you going to give to your kids to the point of where you then lose yourself, your body, your mind, and your spirit, become the sacrificial lamb for those children? And so at some point, like when you're in a, when there's a situation and you're drowning and you can only save one, you can only save either save yourself or save your kid, but you yourself will die in the process. Well, you know how it is out there. Oh God, if you sacrifice yourself for your kid, you are a saint. Well, I guess if you want that kind of. Okay. But see, what would I do? What would it be that scenario? What scenario would I choose if I was in that situation? This is probably not with me in great reviews. But I'll say theoretically, if I had a kid that didn't really have much life experience, and I knew that I had things that I was taking care of, and I finally figured some stuff out. I knew that my kid, you know, I wanted to give my kid everything as far as experiences and lifestyle and all that stuff, and understand how to fight demons and whatever. Okay, but they're not old. There's still a long way to go, and there's still crapshoot. There's so much stuff going on. And I'm the best copy, and I'm not going to die anytime soon, or even at all from natural causes. No cancer in my background, but I just so happen to have a kid, and I happen to release my demons. And either I save myself or save that kid and die in the process. Well, would I be thinking this during that time? I probably wouldn't be in that situation, but theoretically, if I was in that situation, I would probably save myself, because who's going to raise that kid? What are they going to turn that kid into? If you know how to raise a child and you have everything set out to make sure that kid is not going to be a weapon against anyone, and you happen to pass away, or were faced with either you pass away or save that kid, and you pass away and save that kid, and that kid lives on. Even if you had left it in your will, I want my kid raised this way, there's no guarantee that your kids can get raised in a way that is going to be amazing, because you know most people out there are not raising their kids in a way that's going to be helpful in the long run over time. Yeah, they'll do their job. Yeah, they'll be part of the system's, you know, intentions, agenda, and then pass away when it's necessary. But the world that I'm in, if I happen to have a kid right now, and I finally released all my demons, and I'm finally the best copy, I've brought everything back that was released when I had that child, and I was facing that situation, and I was really, you know, and I, if I was, I don't know if I was, yeah, I would probably save myself. And you're like, that's horrible. That's so horrible. Jillian would rather let a child drown than. I mean, it's not even. I wouldn't be in that situation. Actual, in reality, I wouldn't be in that situation. I don't have a child. But I'm not gonna pretend to be a saint either. Oh, I'm gonna save that child. What do you mean save it? So yeah, so now the kid's motherless because there's no father in the picture. Let's just say it's a single mother. Because when you think about it, okay, if there's a father in the background, assuming that father is evolutionary, we haven't still seen yet too much. We know there's fucking smart ass fathers and men out there in the J world. We have still yet to see the longevity part of it. But they definitely have some gifts. Now let's see over time how that's going to translate. We haven't seen over time what men are going to be like in the J world. We're still very new in the process. And so, yeah. So, yeah, there's no guarantee that that kid's going to be raised to be in the way that it needs to be raised, given the climate, given the culture and the society. And so, I mean, I wouldn't be in that position, but I'm not pretending to be a saint. I'm not pretending to be a saint. I don't want to be a saint. Right now, today's Mother's Day, they're all saints. It doesn't matter what they do or do not do. Every mother today is a saint to their husbands, to their children, to themselves. And I'm not playing that. Because are they really a saint? Okay, they gave you life. They gave you everything you wanted. Remember, Universe 25. They got whatever they wanted. The mice experiment. They got whatever they wanted. A utopia, rat utopia. Well, they're gonna cannibalize themselves. They were used for a minute, as the experiment, they got everything they want, unfettered freedoms to eat and procreate, cohabitate, and do stuff and whatever, and they had no predators around them, pretty much a safe environment, never had to really work for anything, really. No, hardly any suffering, if at all, no disease. And guess what? Extinction. So are mothers really saints today? Oh yeah, they are. So you're seeing, so right now the system is like mocking us again because it's whole Mother's Day. Look how many saints out there that are making sure that their kids get everything they could possibly want with absolutely no struggle, no suffering, no anything. Give them all the drugs, give them all the operations, all the toys, the candy, the experiences. They won't really have what it takes to really battle the demons within or even out there. And there are demons out there that are developing in other countries, other places, through the internet. The demons come in and give me kind words. So I sometimes I fall for it and I'm like, oh, that's such a nice, when I was saying something on a public page and I looked at a profile and I'm like, I don't mind entertaining, different diverse people. And there's rainbows on their page. I'm like, oh, okay, cool, an LGBTQ, nice. I let them on the page. And their Facebook looks relatively okay, I guess. And they go right through my freaking email. You're so gorgeous. You're so amazing. Your eyes, I get lost in your eyes. I'm like, oh, you're fucking kidding me. Now, a weaker person who's looking for that kind of validation, nobody's ever said they were beautiful. No one's ever paid any attention to them. They have that kind of demon come through and they fall for it. That's why people get taken advantage of. Because there's demons out there that know there are people who are weak, that have never been exposed to anything outside of their culture, never really had to suffer, didn't understand the ways of the world. And so a demon comes worming their way into the world, telling them they're beautiful. They're gorgeous. They think they're remarkable. And so these girls, boys, women, men who have been given a utopian lifestyle, they're being set up for the SLAUGHTER. Because inevitably, a demon out there who's looking to survive and take resources will find every way to complement them to DEATH. To the point of where the person is giving their money, their body, their mind, their spirit, and even these young girls on Facebook showing everything to everybody and their kids, and they're desperate for a man or a woman or something. The demons worm their way in, and you hope that they survive the lessons. But if their parents have given them everything, don't teach them the ways of the world, never really had to struggle. They're just ripe for the. So that's the thing. So yeah, Mother's Day. My mother's so great. Oh, I'm sure she is. I'm sure she is. I don't doubt that at all. And yeah. So, Jillian, you sound so bitter. You were not loved right as a child. I have fought more demons. I have suffered more. I have figured some shit out on my own that some people, a lesser person, would not survive what I went through. Even on my own. They wouldn't be able to do what I was doing because they wouldn't have that capacity. They were never given that conditioning process. Oh, but that should everyone go through? You don't have to go as far as what the sciences do, but I'll tell you, saying no once in a while ain't a bad fucking thing. Saying no once in a while, but even saying no once in a while, how far do you take it? Because kids are gonna take things so far. You know what? I don't even have a fucking answer. So yeah, we're gonna have a bunch of saints out there. They'll give their kids everything, give them the paradise. So I don't know. So I mean, I do know, and it really, when you think about it, people are learning the hard way. So how far do you take giving your kids boundaries and giving them? I just, in my opinion, again, if I had a kid, I expose them to so much without traumatizing them, and explain everything in clinical ways, but also know that they will have demons, and those demons will come out, and it will be a war. That's what I'm saying, with between mothers and daughters and sons and kids and parents, a lot of wars out there. And so if there isn't a war between the parents and the children, then there's a war inside brewing. And will they have what it takes to fight the battles? If they haven't figured out how to win the war between you all, because yeah, parents and kids, there's always a war at some point. Because your kids want to do something, they want to push the boundaries, and parents either says yes or no. But then, how, I mean, do they, when they do say yes, go do that, and they get into a situation, what did you learn from that situation? Did you bail them out? How much suffering can they handle? Da 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 da. See, that's like, that takes a really aware parent to understand the necessity of suffering, but how much is too much, and who's catalyzing it, and then, yeah. And our parents equipped nowadays now. So they just give them whatever. They just, yeah. It's easier, and the system is not going to allow you to let people suffer too much because they don't know to what extent you're going to allow that suffering. So, yeah, so the whole J world, I mean, obviously it isn't for everyone, but understand that that we have been under extreme amounts of experiments, and that you have a way to release those demons. And at this point, you can step out of the war, because the war is only going to destroy you. Like, literally, it's going to destroy you. You have to release those demons. You have to eat food. You've got to give yourself the time and figure out who it is that you're working for and why, who it is that you're giving your energy to 100% of the time and why, and can you recoup the resources lost? And if you can't do any of that, then yeah, you'll fight until you're exhausted and lay down and pass away. And I'm saying, you don't have, it doesn't have to be that way, but if it's necessary and you have to do it because there's no other way and you're locked into a lifestyle belief system, remember, no one is your enemy. No one's out to get you. There is no enemy. I'm not your enemy. The government is your enemy. Climate change isn't the enemy. Okay, evolution has to happen or else you get all out extinction. But you now have to survive whatever is going on. And you can't stop what's going on. There's no fucking way to stop it. Because it's your friends and family that are all part of it too. They have the licenses. They go to their jobs every single day and do their part in all the widgets of the system. Okay, so you can't, so, and you're part of it too. And so what do? You save yourself, even though you're contributing to the system overall of its own evolution, which is either death and reproduction, both handing or both happening simultaneously. But you save yourself. If you know that, yeah, that you can't stop what's going on because it's you part of it, and it's also your friends and family and everyone around you, then you save yourself. There's no one to fight. There's no enemy. Save yourself. You can't save your kids if they're not willing to save themselves. You can't save the guy next door. You can't save their kids. You can't save those animals all the time. Because someone's breeding more animals out there. And then someone's releasing them. And then someone's picking them up and putting them in the shelter. And then someone's saving them. And someone's breeding them. So they're undermining. And so what, you spend your life saving everything until you're exhausted and you're basically passed out? And don't ever wake up again because you're so busy saving animals, children, other humans who don't have a clue. But that's the system of sainthood. That's America. The last greatest experiment. But I'm enjoying now watching old movies. Like, I seriously enjoy watching old movies, because now I know that's also part of the, that was my background, the people I was that raised me as a nurture versus nature. And when I'm stressed out, there's music, there's art, literature, there's outside, there's reading, there's figuring out formulas. Excuse me. Wow. There is strangulating me. There is so much stuff that I can turn to channel my energy without trying to destroy somebody else, without looking for an enemy, without developing an enemy, Because I'm not doing anything wrong to anyone. I'm just asking the world to question their identity, to question their lifestyle, their belief system. That's all I'm doing. That's not against the law. That's not what makes an enemy, is to question your identity, to question what's going to ultimately destroy you if you're trying to save yourself, save your kids, save your friends and family. Okay? So instead of saving them, why don't you save yourself? That means if you want to save yourself, maybe question everything that you once believed. But if you're not willing to save yourself, you want to save other people, that was the intention. All your activism to save some stranger who doesn't give a shit about you, that was the intention. When Gloria Estefan said, as a joke to all the people in the audience, everyone should shake their hands, but look behind you and shake the person's hand behind you. So we all look behind us. And no one's looking at each other because we're all looking the other way. She could have said, shake the hand to the person next to you. And so they had to choose who it is. You just go like this, right? But shaking the hand of someone behind you? Everyone's looking the other direction. That's exactly what's going on in the activism. You're looking behind you to shake someone's hand, and they're looking, but and someone in front of you is looking at you, but you're looking at somebody else, and they're looking at somebody else, and looking at somebody else, and that was the intention. That's the depopulation agenda. Bye.